Today, let us first begin with the statement of the classification theorem. We begin with a group G and a connected, locally path connected, semi-locally simply connected space B with a base point B naught, and it's simply connected covering P from E to B. Of course, that also has a base point E naught mapped on to B naught. Let, of course, G be any group I have already told. G, curly GB denote the set of all equivalence classes of G coverings of P. Then assignment alpha going to E alpha, where alpha is an element of home pi 1 BB naught G. There is a homomorphism from the fundamental group into the given group G. You construct the group extension action G covering E alpha, starting with the J covering E. Then take its equivalence class. That is a map alpha from E, alpha going to E alpha, which we have denoted by mu. This is a canonical bijection. Notice that on the right hand side, you have equivalence classes. On the left hand side, they are just the set of all homomorphisms. Okay. In particular, if G is abelian, this set becomes a group. Otherwise, may not be a group. So the equivalence classes of G coverings, they themselves form a group in a strange way. So this is actually a consequence of this bijection. In fact, what we want to do is, we have already defined the inverse map, the so-called inverse map, we haven't verified it, new from GB to home JG. And we want to show that this mu and nu are inverses of each other. So the first thing is to show that mu composite nu is identity and nu composite mu is identity. And then there is a part which says canonical part. There are, so these three main parts are there. To start with a equivalence class of a G covering, which I denote by zeta. After all, total spaces of E prime, P prime, B. Okay. And then, because E is the universal covering, you will have a map P bar from E to E prime, which is actually lift of P through P prime. If you make it base point going to base point, then this is a unique map. So take a homomorphism alpha from G to G, given by the equation 19, whatever the equation was. Let us have a look at equation 19 and come back here. Yeah. So you start with a loop representing the given element of the pi 1, lift it, look at the endpoint. The P bar of the endpoint is in the same fiber as E naught prime inside E prime. Therefore, it is related to E naught prime by an element of G. That G is alpha of omega. This is the definition defining relation for alpha. Okay. So you have to remember this. I will be using it again perhaps. So where are we now? So we have this defining relation. Now consider the assignment G comma E going to G of P bar E. Okay. So I want to say that this assignment respects the equivalence classes. See, first I want to define. Finally, what I want to define, a map from E alpha to E prime. okay, so that this becomes a G-map, so that these two are equivalent. So before that, to define a map like this, I will define it from G cross E, it's G comma E, G cross E into E prime. Then I will show that it respects the relations there, the defining relation for E alpha. Okay, so what is that? An element GE is equivalent to G times alpha H and H inverse of E for any element F, H of the fundamental group J. Okay, so this is equivalent to this one. Okay, this one is mapped to, by the definition, G times alpha H, the first part, and then P bar of H inverse E. Okay, but this is same thing as G times alpha H as it is, P bar of H inverse is alpha of H inverse times P bar of E. This is just what the definition of alpha tells you. Just now what we, equation 19. So alpha H and alpha H inverse cancel away. What you are left with is G of P bar of E, which is the definition of this map GE. GE goes to G of P bar of E. So all the elements which are equivalent to this one also go into the same map. Therefore, we get a well-defined map from the quotient, and that I am calling it as F. Okay. So if it commutes with the projection maps, it's obvious because of the definition here. Okay, so it is a covering transformation from E alpha to E prime is the zeta. That is the G covering. Moreover, let us look at F of, instead of just one element, G2 times E multiplied by G1. So what happens to this? By definition, you see F of G1, G2, E. But F of G1, G2, E is G1, G2, P bar E. But that is same thing as G1 of G2, P bar E is nothing but F of G2, E. So G1 has come out. It just means that F is a G map. Between G coverings, any G map is an isomorphism, is what we have seen. So therefore, see, starting with E prime, we looked at alpha, and then we performed this E of alpha, which is mu. And now we are showing that this is equivalent to the original E prime. So nu of mu, nu first and then mu is identity. This is what we have got. Nu of mu is identity. Now let us look at the other way around. Now I start with a homomorphism instead of starting with a equivalence class of G covering. Start with the homomorphism J to G. Then you perform the extension E beta. Okay. By the very definition, E beta is nothing but for any omega beyond J, we have 1 comma P omega of E is beta omega of E. Therefore, if omega tilde is a lift of omega in E at the point E naught, P bar omega tilde is a path from the base point 1 comma E naught to 1 comma omega tilde of 1. This is the path applying omega, which is nothing but this omega tilde of 1 by dimension is 1 comma phi omega of E naught. That's the definition of phi omega. Okay. So, but that is same thing as beta omega of E naught. Why? Because this action of omega comes on this side, equivalence class, under beta. So it's beta omega comes out, beta omega 1 E naught. Therefore, from the definition, again, equation, okay, equation 19, for alpha, this means that this should have given you alpha. Alpha must be equal to beta. So starting with the beta, you take E beta, okay, that is mu, and then the corresponding homomorphism is back to alpha itself, whatever alpha, okay. So this alpha must be this beta. So mu of is identity, okay. Remember that one way we get equality for the homomorphisms. Other way here, we are only showing that the two G coverings are equivalent under F. They are equal, they are not, may not be the same, but they are equivalent under the G maps. Okay, so keep that in mind. Okay, so this shows that mu is a bijection. The next thing is we have to verify that it is a canonical map, canonical bijection. So what is the meaning of the canonical? I have to explain you and then prove that one. This is the meaning. Take any function f from b prime to b. Let us choose a base point b naught prime going to b naught. That will induce a homomorphism from pi 1 of b prime b naught, I am going to call it as j prime, to pi 1 of this, j. There is a homomorphism from here to here, this f check. When you compose any homomorphism from pi 1, this j to g, with f check, what you get is a homomorphism from j prime to g. So that is f check star. Okay, so this is the homomorphism, this is the map from home to home, which are under mu correspond to the equivalence classes of g coverings over b, and here equivalence classes of g coverings over b prime. Okay, so whether you first take f check and then go to mu, or first take mu. Okay, well, this way, you have to go this way. First you take mu and then take f check, f star. F star is what? The pullback of the g covering over b to a g covering over b prime. Or you first take f check here, convert the map alpha into a homomorphism alpha into homomorphism from j prime to that. And then take the extension from E prime. Remember, whenever we do this mu, it has to be, you have to use corresponding universal cover, corresponding simply connected cover, and then extend the group structure to G. You do that, you get a G cover over B prime. So this diagram commutes. So it is totally independent of what f is. You see, the same f star you have to take though. Here, homomorphisms at pi 1 level are induced by f. This one is induced by again f. It's a pullback of the bundles, pullback of the coverings. You can put mu from gb to here by reversing the arrow here, because that is just the inverse of this. If you reverse the arrows here and put new here, that will be also commutative, provided you prove this one. Alternatively, if you prove that, then this will get proved, because mu and nu are inverses of each other. Okay, so the whole point is we have defined a mu not by one single set home. We have defined it for all possible different, if you change B, if you change G, the domain of mu will change. But the change, if it corresponds under F, under a continuous function, then there is a commutativity of the diagrams. This is the whole idea. Okay. So once again, the important thing here is to understand what is happening at the universal cover level, namely in simply connected cover level under this F check. You have a map from F from B prime to B. It induces homomorphism at the pi 1 level. It also gives you a map from E prime to E, the lift of F, because E prime is simply connected. I am taking simply connected covering E prime over B prime. That F check has F bar, whatever, the lift of F, okay, will have something to say about the group GP, GP prime on one side and GP on the other side. That is the thing that you have to understand. Once you understand that, the canonical property falls out very quickly. Okay. So once again, you have to identify pi 1 with the group of Corrin transformations to understand this again and again. Okay. So under this identification, okay, we must figure out what the homomorphism F check from pi 1 of B prime to pi 1 of B B naught corresponds to. Okay. So as usual, P from E to B, P prime, P prime simply connected covering spaces with base point preserving, etc. Note that there is a unique map F bar, E bar to E, such that F composite P prime equal to P composite F bar. I am just taking this composite base. This is simply connected, so it is a lift. If you specify the base point, it's a unique lift. That's all that has been used. So F bar of E prime is E naught. Okay. Now, a covering transformation psi from E prime to E prime corresponds to an element omega prime of pi 1 of B prime B naught. What is the rule? The rule is the endpoint of the lift of omega twiddle is a lift, is equal to psi of E naught prime of the base point. Same story inside E to E also, which you have been using. Okay. Now the point is, if you take an omega prime in pi 1 of BB prime, if you can add F check of that, F composite that will be a loop in pi 1 of B at B naught. That is the way F check is defined at pi 1 level by just take composition with the F, right? So it follows that F bar of the lift of omega inside omega prime inside E prime will be the lift of omega inside E. F bar, if you come on this side, from take a loop here, lift it here, push it via F bar, the same thing as first you push it and then lift it by the uniqueness of the lifts. Okay, so that will tell you what is the relation between these covering transformations under F bar. Okay, so it follows that we have F check of psi. Psi is an element of the covering transformation, or think of this as now an element of pi 1 operating out on E naught. This is why I'm taking it as a group of, as a covering transformation. It is equal to F bar of omega prime to 1 by definition, but that is same thing as F bar of psi E naught prime. Okay, so this covering is defined by this. This is also another lift. So once you fix the effect of base point, it's uniquely defined. That is what I am telling. Okay. Since both psi f composite f bar composite psi are lifts of the same f composite p bar, and agree at one point, these psi of its one must be equal to f bar of psi. So this is the commutative diagram that you have. You have a covering transformation here. There will be a covering transformation there, psi f check of psi. If this corresponds to the fundamental group element, F check of that will be this element. That's why I have written F check of psi. Okay, the current transmission is precisely that. So the F check can be thought of as a map from the covering transformation GP prime to GP under these identifications. So that is also a canonical property. Okay. Start with any continuous function here, base point preserving. Then these identifications of universal covering and the covering transformations in the fundamental group, that itself is canonical. Okay, so this picture tells you that. Now we can complete the proof of canonical property, the commutative diagram of this commutative square from home J prime G to home J G, etc. Start with the homomorphism from J to G. Compose it with F check to get a homomorphism from J prime to G. Remember, J F check is J prime to J, then again followed by F, we get a J prime to G. So let us call it as beta. Now consider the pullback covering F star of E alpha. F star of E alpha by definition is the equivalence class of this one is F star of mu of alpha. On the other hand, you can take F check of alpha, that's beta, and then perform the extension, that's mu of that. This is E prime of beta. What you have to show that these two are in the same class, namely this equivalence classes are the same. So in order to show that F star composite mu is mu composite F check, we shall define a map here, which is a G map. That would mean that the equivalence class of this as a G covering is equal to equivalence class of this one as a G covering. This lambda should be a G map. That's all we want. All right, a continuous function which respects the G actions. Then you are done. So to define a map from here to here, I will use the universal property of the pullback, F star of E alpha. Remember what F star of E alpha was. E alpha itself is a G covering, right? It's a covering projection. There is a projection map from E alpha to B. We will denote by P prime. This is our notation anyway. F is a map from B prime to B. Pullback, let us call the total space as Z. We know that it is a subgroup, it is subspace of E alpha cross B prime and so on. That we know already. There are pi 1 and pi 2 projection maps here. So this map pi 2 is the pullback cover, G cover. We want to show that this cover and E prime beta, these two are equivalent. That means I must find a lambda here, which suggests this triangle is commutative, and this lambda must be what? Lambda must be a G map. This is what we want to do. To define this, there is a unique way, there is an easy way of doing the whole thing using the universal covering of Z. What I have to do, define a map from here to E alpha and a one here to B prime, such that when you compose with F and P prime, when you come up to B, they are the same. This one is same thing as this compose this one. Then there will be a unique map here. This map is already given to you. So you want this one to fit here. So you choose this one so that this compose this one, that's all. So what is this map? Well, if you just look at what are those elements, this map comes automatically. Okay. So that this has to be commutative, right? So let pi 2 prime be the covering projection, this pi 2 prime. This is the covering projection defining E prime beta. So what is it? It is, by very definition, pi 2 prime of G E prime is P prime of E prime. Okay. There is a somewhat overlapping, this may be, I should denote this one by a different notation here. This was P prime was used for covering projection from E prime to B prime. Okay, so this is this notation, I should change it to Q, some other thing. Okay, there is a typo here, but this P prime is canonical notation. E to E, P to E, B, and the other one is E prime, P prime, B prime. So that is a nice notation. Let us not change that one. So to get a map lambda, we need to map phi 1 prime from E prime this one, such that when you compose with this Q, phi 1 prime of Q composite phi 1 prime must be equal to F composite phi 2 prime. Okay, that's what we want to define. So where this is the covering projection, this is Q. Huh? And that, what is the definition of that? That is GE equal to GE goes to PE. This is obtained by the original P from E to B, the universal covering there. So this is the definition of P prime. Okay. So I just take pi 1 prime of G E prime equal to, don't disturb G at all, G F bar of E prime. Okay. Why this is well defined? If there is a class here, equivalence classes here, why they go to the same equivalence classes here? That's what you have to do. So that is what I have to check. Under the equivalence relation on G cross E prime, defining what is this one? Remember, this is E prime of beta, extension of E prime to B prime by the homomorphism beta, right? So it's a quotient of G cross E prime. The defining E prime of B prime, what is the relation? Relation is G times G comma H times E prime is, this H is transferred to the other side with a beta H, G of beta H times E prime. Okay. So I have to show that these two elements go to the same element under pi 1 prime. Okay. But what is the defining relations here on in this is inside E alpha? We have the first G of F bar of H E prime. I am talking about the image of this one, G of F bar of H E prime. This is by definition F check of H F bar of E prime. Right? We have just seen that F bar of H, F bar of psi. The same thing as psi F check of psi, that's what we have seen, that F bar composite psi is F check of psi. I am referring to this picture. F bar composite psi is F check of this one, F bar of that. Okay, so F check of that, F bar of E prime. That is equivalent to, now this is an element in the group, right? So it can be pushed to the other side. G times alpha, after taking alpha of F check of H, then it is just F bar of E prime. But alpha of F check is by definition beta. So this is G of beta H, F bar of E prime. Now look at this element. Under pi 1 prime, precisely it comes to this one. So if these two are equivalent, their images are equal. Therefore, pi 1 prime is well defined. Okay. It is easy to say that if you compose with Q, okay, further, so I am writing P prime here again, Q of pi 1 prime is by definition P of F bar of E prime. But that is F of P prime of E prime. But that is F of pi 2 prime of G E prime. You see the relation between the E and E alphas and E prime and E prime beta. The quotient maps are defined using the original P or P prime. Okay, this you just change it as Q here, that's all. Therefore, we get a map lambda from E prime B. What we have verified here is this composite, this is equal to this composite. Therefore, there's a unique map lambda here, and you know how it is defined. It is defined as pi 1 prime comma pi 2 prime of an element here. It's order tuple of the first coordinate and second coordinate. So that is lambda, okay? So lambda of GE prime is, the first coordinate is, yes, G comma F bar of E prime. This is this whole thing is first coordinate. Second coordinate is P prime of E. Okay. That this is a G map is very obvious, because if G1, G2, if you put here, okay, so that is G1, G2 will come here, nothing happens here. That G1, G2, G1 will come out here. This is the same thing as you can come put it all the way outside by the definition of this action. Action on the pullback. So it is a G map. Okay, so this completes the proof of the entire theorem. As promised, we shall use this one in the final result of proving various forms of Van Kampen's theorem. Thank you.